Phoenix Audio presents
The Seven Story Mountain by Thomas Merton. Read by Sidney Lanier.
On the last day of January 1915, under the sign of the Water Bearer, in a year of a great war, and down in the shadow of some French mountains on the borders of Spain, I came into the world. Free by nature, in the image of God, I was nevertheless the prisoner of my own violence and my own selfishness, in the image of the world into which I was born. That world was the picture of hell, full of men like myself, loving God and yet hating Him, born to love Him, living instead in fear and hopeless, self-contradictory hungers. Not many hundreds of miles away from the house where I was born, they were picking up the men who rotted in the rainy ditches among the dead horses and the ruined 75s in the forest of trees without branches along the River Marne. My father and mother were captives in that world, knowing they did not belong with it or in it, and yet unable to get away from it. They were in the world and not of it, not because they were saints, but in a different way, because they were artists. The integrity of an artist lifts a man above the level of the world without delivering him from it. My father painted like Cézanne and understood the southern French landscape the way Cézanne did. His vision of the world was sane, full of balance, full of veneration for structure, for the relations of masses, and for all the circumstances that impress an individual identity on each created thing. His vision was religious and clean, and therefore his paintings were without decoration or superfluous comment, since a religious man respects the power of God's creation to bear witness for itself. My father was a very good artist. Neither of my parents suffered from the little spooky prejudices that devour the people who know nothing but automobiles and movies, and what's in the icebox, and what's in the papers, and which neighbors are getting a divorce. I inherited from my father his way of looking at things, and some of his integrity, and from my mother some of her dissatisfaction with the mess the world is in, and some of her versatility. From both I got capacities for work and vision, and enjoyment and expression that ought to have made me some kind of a king, if the standards the world lives by were the real ones. Not that we ever had any money, but any fool knows that you don't need money to get enjoyment out of life. If what most people take for granted were really true, if all you needed to be happy was to grab everything and see everything and investigate every experience and then talk about it, I should have been a very happy person. A spiritual millionaire, from the cradle even until now. If happiness were merely a matter of natural gifts, I would never have entered a Trappist monastery when I came to the age of a man. My father and mother came from the ends of the earth to Prades, and though they came to stay, they stayed there barely long enough for me to be born and get on my small feet, and then they left again. And they continued, and I began a somewhat long journey. For all three of us, one way or another, it is now ended. I was barely a year old. I remember nothing about the journey as we went to Bordeaux to take the boat that had a gun mounted on the foredeck. I remember nothing about the crossing of the sea, nothing of the anxiety about U-boats, or the arrival in New York, and in the land where there was no war. But I can easily reconstruct the first encounter between my American grandparents and their new son-in-law and their grandson. For Pop, as my American grandfather was called in the family, was a buoyant and excitable man who on docks, boats, trains, in stations, in elevators, on buses, in hotels, in restaurants, used to get keyed up and start ordering everybody around and making new arrangements and changing them on the spur of the moment. My grandmother, whom we called Bon Maman, was just the opposite, and her natural deliberateness and hesitancy and hatred of activity always seemed to increase in proportion to Pop's excesses in the opposite direction. I have no doubt there was a certain amount of conflict between the two generations when father and mother determined that they were going to find their own kind of a house and live in it. It was a small house, very old and rickety, standing under two or three high pine trees in Flushing, Long Island, which was then a country town. Father could not support us by painting. During the war years, we lived on his work as a landscape gardener, which was mostly plain manual labor, for he not only laid out the gardens of some rich people in the neighborhood, but did most of the work, planting and caring for them. And that was how we lived. Father did not get his money under false pretenses. He was a very good gardener, understood flowers, and knew how to make things grow. What is more, he liked this kind of work almost as much as painting. Then in November 1918, about a week before the armistice of that particular World War, my younger brother was born. He was a child with a much serener nature than mine, with not so many obscure drives and impulses. I remember that everyone was impressed by his constant and unruffled happiness. In the long evenings, when he was put to bed before the sun went down, instead of protesting and fighting as I did when I had to go to bed, he would lie upstairs in his crib, and we would hear him singing a little tune. Every evening it was the same tune, very simple, very primitive, a nice little tune, very suitable for the time of day and for the season. Downstairs, we would all fall more or less silent, lulled by the singing of the child in the crib, and we would see the sun rays slanting across the fields and through the windows as the day ended. By 1920, I could read and write and draw. I drew a picture of the house and everybody sitting under the pine trees on a blanket on the grass and sent it to Pop in the mail. He lived at Douglaston, which was about 5 miles away. But most of the time I drew pictures of boats, ocean liners with many funnels and hundreds of portholes and waves all around as jagged as a saw, and the air full of V's for the seagulls. Things were stimulated by the momentous arrival of my New Zealand grandmother, who had come from the Antipodes to visit her scattered children in England and America as soon as the war had ended. I think she brought one of my aunts along with her, but I was most of all impressed by Granny. She taught me the Lord's Prayer. Perhaps I had been taught to say the Our Father before by my earthly father. I never used to say it. But evidently Granny asked me one night if I had said my prayers, and it turned out that I did not know the Our Father, so she taught it to me. After that, I did not forget it, even though I went for years without saying it at all. It seems strange that father and mother, who were concerned almost to the point of scrupulosity about keeping the minds of their sons uncontaminated by error and mediocrity and ugliness and sham, had not bothered to give us any formal religious training. The only explanation I have is the guess that mother must have had strong views on the subject. Possibly she considered any organized religion below the standard of intellectual perfection she demanded of any child of hers. We never went to church in Flushing. My education was progressing along the lines laid down by some progressive method that mother had read about in one of those magazines. She answered an advertisement that carried an oval portrait of some bearded scholar with a pince-nez and received from Baltimore a set of books and some charts and even a small desk and blackboard. The idea was that the smart modern child was to be turned loose amid this apparatus and allowed to develop spontaneously into a midget university before reaching the age of 10. The ghost of John Stuart Mill must have glided up and down the room with a sigh of gratification as I opened the desk and began. If we had continued as we had begun, and if John Paul and I had grown up in that house, probably this Victorian Greek complex would have built itself up gradually, and we would have turned into good-mannered and earnest skeptics, polite, intelligent, and perhaps even in some sense useful. We might have become successful authors, or editors of magazines, professors at small progressive colleges. The way would have been all smooth, and perhaps I would never have ended up as a monk. But it is not yet the time to talk about that happy consummation, the thing for which I most thank and praise God, and which is, of all things, the ultimate paradoxical fulfillment of my mother's ideas for me, the last thing she would have ever dreamed of, the boomerang of all her solicitude for an individual development. But oh, how many possibilities there were ahead of me and my brother in that day. A brand new conscience was just coming into existence as an actual operating function of a soul. My choices were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.